All right, thanks. It is a pretty good crowd given the consideration of the weather out there. So thanks for everybody for showing up. I really like this program. I've got a long history in the Great Decisions program, and it's always an honor for me to be asked to participate. I think you got a great lineup of topics this year, as you always do, and so I would encourage you. Hopefully we got a lot of folks here that are longtime members of Great Decisions. You got a great lineup of topics. I would argue that this is probably your most important one. All right, good. I mean, of course I would argue that. But I think, in reality, when you think about this issue of trade, both from a domestic consideration about U.S. economic policy domestically, trade's going to be a big driver, and what we talk about today is going to be a big driver. But it goes way beyond just domestic policy. I mean, I think this is going to be one of the big drivers in terms of international economic policy, but also international security policy. So this is a big topic. So these are... See if I got this to work. I guess I didn't. I didn't check it out ahead of time. All right, how do I get the clicker to work? Yeah, you shouldn't have to. You should be able to walk around. Anybody back there can tell me how to work the clicker? Okay, as I was saying, maybe it's out of batteries. Okay, so the next little chart is a cartoon that presents my credentials. And it's a Dilbert cartoon, and it talks about this bald guy who gets picked to be the economist because he was engaged in a lot of economic babble. So are there any economists in the crowd? Any economists in the crowd? All right, so we do have one. All right, so the tough questions are going to go to you in the Q&A period. Notice I did not raise my hand. I'm not an economist. You know, if you listen to Mike as he was talking about my background, I have spent a lot of time studying and teaching about economic issues, not in a theoretical sense, but more in a political economy, a policy sense. And so that's what brings me to this particular talk. So we're going to talk about three things today: trade, jobs, and politics. And there's a fourth thing. You know, I'm already into my third slide, so we'll have to catch up. But there's the fourth thing that wasn't on the slide, so this is probably pretty good. The fourth item that I wanted to put on there is dialogue. So my goal is to get through a lot of material. Oh, there we go. So there's the Dilbert cartoon. Now if I can get the next one. All right, there's the agenda. I don't know if I'm going to get the clicker back or not. This will be a little bit inconvenient if I don't. But so there's the agenda, and like I said, that last bullet is going to be dialogue. So my goal is to get through an awful lot of material in a relatively short period of time. If you had seat belts, I'd tell you to buckle up right now because there might be some turbulence out there too. And we're going to sort of go through this, but I do want to have as much time as possible for dialogue and Q&A because I think that's the strength of the program, the Great Decisions program. So the next one, please. Am I going to have to do this? All right. So I think this is really applicable to this particular topic. You know, it ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble. It's what you know for sure that just ain't so. So I'm just challenging you. I mean, these are complicated. It's the complicated bits and pieces of this topic. And then they all come together. So it's very complex because they have influence on one another. And we all have opinions about it. And I'm not saying they're right or wrong, but I think it's important to challenge ourselves to really think through some of these issues about trade, jobs, and then the politics that are associated with it. Okay, so the next one, please. So we're going to start on trade. This is another cartoon I think is really, if you take a look at that and think about what's happening there, there's a lot of truth in that particular political cartoon. Okay, next. So I'm assuming that a lot of you have, you know, had some basic economics in college, or perhaps if you were in a high-speed high school program. I certainly didn't get it in high school. And what I got in my initial college, any West Point grads out there, you can plug your ears, wasn't very good either. But I picked up from there on out. And so this is the basic theory, and you've probably all been exposed to this. So there's comparative advantage, which allows specialization, and that leads to, in a trade context, that, you know, we open up the world to this competition. And so the competition gives us lower prices, gives us better quality, gives us more consumer choices. All of that is good. We all like that. And it also drives for the efficient use of resources. Because when we talk about trade, and you're going to see that today, I mean, that sort of the flip side of trade is international investment. So we can either trade in goods and services, or we can have these foreign direct investment either come from a foreign nation in the United States or United States to a foreign nation and build that stuff in that country. So they're sort of all combined. So all of that, that first little set of that, that's good for all of us. And then you can think, you know, globally, you know, the diffusion of technology, it improves stability because less developed countries are going to advance, and it's going to improve prosperity. And how can you argue with the bottom point? World peace. So, you know, it's going to lead to world peace. So we're happy about that. All right, so the next one, please. However, and this is part of the theory, there are winners and losers. And so the argument is that writ large, we are all winners because of trade, for all of those things we just talked about. However, there are folks out there that are going to be losers. And whether or not they are in the horse carriage industry or the whale oil industry or something like that, an industry that's going to go out or jobs are going to go someplace else, the skill level that's required to be competitive is going to increase. So there are losers. And part of what we're dealing with now, and actually for a number of years, there's more recognition and there's more focus on the losers that are associated with this equation. And so that's one of the challenges that I think we have as a society, and we'll come back to that. Next one, please. Okay, so this whole trade theory thing is the underpinnings of what I would argue has been our national security policy and national economic policy since the end of World War II. And so I know the lecturer on the energy policy, Brian Stinchfield, talked a lot about this worldview. And so just a quick summary. So we think about this liberal international order. And there's four propositions that are up here. One, commercial liberalism or free market trade is going to lead to economic independence, which is a good thing. Then this liberal institutions, we create institutions which are rule-based and establish norms. That's going to be a good thing to foster international and global cooperation and collaboration. All of that's going to be associated with democratic governments. There's this relationship that if you're a free market economy, you're generally going to either evolve into, or you already are, a democratic political apparatus. And then you're going to get this modernization theory would argue that as a country is modernizing, so a lesser developed country is going to go along this path. So the sort of the same evolution of both the market economy and a democratic government. So all that's a good thing. Next, please. All right, so there's a quick little quote from Cordell Hull, who was FDR's Secretary of State. So now he's talking at the end of World War II, this great cataclysm that impacted the entire world. And he says, you know, only if we had free trade, you know, maybe we could have avoided what we just went through, World War II. And so that's this argument that it will go a long way toward eliminating war itself. Okay, so we got these four underlying propositions. Next, please. And so that leads to specific prescriptions about policy. So this is called the Washington Consensus. It's the Washington Consensus you see up there in the upper right-hand corner, the American flag, because we believe that. We, being the U.S. government, believes that these are the right policies. But also the World Bank and the IMF do. And the World Bank and the IMF headquarters are in Washington, D.C., just a stone's throw away from the Capitol, from the White House. And so they believe this whole line of, you know, this is how your economy should run. And so there's all these kind of different policies, macroeconomic, financial policies. But the last two, the market economy should be based on the market. We should have market-based economies. And you should work towards global integration, both for trade and investment, foreign direct investment. And so that's sort of the underlying prescription. Next, please. So how are we doing? How's the world done? So, you know, the world has adopted this approach, generally speaking, after World War II. And you can see on this chart, on the left-hand side, you see that trade is going up. Does this think it works? We'll give it a whirl. The trade has gone up dramatically. Down here at the bottom, you see that global GDP has increased very significantly. And then at the upper right corner, you get that chart that talks about global poverty. Extreme poverty has gone down very significantly. And then this folks that are not living in extreme poverty has gone up. So that's this growing global middle class. And this is this world, Robert Kagan's small book, that this is the world America made. So U.S. in terms of after World War II, the Bretton Woods systems and all these institutions and all this policy. This is a world that we and our allies essentially put together from a global international structure. And it's doing pretty good. So we'll see if it works. There we go. So there's that stability and prosperity that we talked about. Now, that's post-World War II, and so that whole period post-World War II, but we've also seen a dramatic change in the economic and strategic environment after the end of the Cold War in 1990s. And so it went hand in hand, the big geopolitical change, the collapse of the Soviet Union, and the opening up of that entire communist world, along with big technological changes. And so we have this big push for globalization. So Tom Friedman, in this particular book, The World is Flat, lots of readings out there, and you're all familiar with this, and we'll come back and talk about this topic. So he says there's four drivers to globalization. So the first thing was declining transportation costs. So now it's a lot cheaper to ship things across the oceans. So transportation costs are down. Information technology, we all know how that has changed just about everything we do. The World Trade Organization came into effect in 1995. So we had this opening up of trade, dramatic reductions in tariffs. And then the final thing up there is this opening of capital markets. Capital markets were largely closed up until about 1970. And then they've opened up. Now, there's good news and bad news about that. But at any rate, they have opened up. And so those four things have really led to this globalization of world economies, this integration. And then you combine that with this expanded free market. The Soviet Union is gone. China starts to modernize its economic approach, recognizing that socialism's not really working. So you have 6 billion more people that are added to this free economy, 1.6 billion more workers. We have doubled the number of workers. And all that happens in a very, very short period of time. So that's globalization in terms of its impact. So how's the U.S. done? All right, so let's look at what the U.S. performance is here. And you see that, trade. Well, we're the number one trading country in the world. Number two is China. Maybe there's a correlation there. The number one and number two economies are the number one and number two trading countries. But trade is gone up tremendously. And if you look up in the upper right-hand corner, from an absolute sense, we've done pretty good. We're the largest economy, almost $18 trillion economy. GDP per capita, gross domestic product per capita is $51,000, north of $51,000 a piece. So we've done pretty good in this international economic environment. However, there's always a however to a lot of these stories. So people are catching up to us. So from an absolute sense, we've done pretty well. But from a relative sense, we're starting to look over our shoulders now. And you might not be able to see, but this is a projection. Now, this is global domestic product purchasing power parity, so a little bit different measurement here. And it shows here by 2030 that China is going to be a larger economy than the United States. In that particular depiction, quite significantly larger. People would argue that already today the Chinese economy on a purchasing power parity basis is larger than the U.S. economy. But they're catching up, and things are going to get worse as we go forward. So we're not too happy about that. And then this little picture up here from Stiglitz's book, The $3 Trillion War, talking about the overall costs of the wars in Afghanistan and in Iraq, the burdens of global leadership are starting to weigh heavy on us. So we're starting to have some second thoughts about this global international economy. And that's part of what the drivers are today. All right, you've seen this chart. This was the chart that was used by Colonel Moffitt last week in his discussion on economics. So these are our major trading partners. So the upper half there are the folks that we sell stuff to. These are our exports. The lower half are the people that we buy stuff from. These are the major trading partners. So now one of the things, you know, we talk about trade agreements. A lot of discussion about trade agreements, and we're obviously going to get into that in greater depth. But as you look at that, with the exception of Canada and Mexico, up here in terms of buyers, down here in terms of sellers to us, you know, nobody else has got a free trade agreement with the United States. They're all under the umbrella of the World Trade Organization. So we're the number one trading nation. We're the number one importing nation. We're the number two exporting nation. So we're not at the bottom of the totem pole when it comes to trading. We do pretty good in that particular realm. Okay, so how do we do it? How do we trade? So there's three ways that you can look at this. This is how we adopt trade policy. So one, you can do it on a global basis, and that's the World Trade Organization. Two, you can have regional groups, multilateral arrangements, and so there's the NAFTA example up there. And the third is you can have bilateral trade agreements. All right, so this is what the lineup looks like. So you see in the upper right-hand corner, that's the WTO logo, World Trade Organization, 164 members, 96.8% of global economic power, gross domestic product, is included by those 164 nations. 96.4% of global trade. So, you know, all the economies of any consequence are in the WTO. And we are members of the WTO. So you take away all of these trade agreements, the TPP and whatever it happens to be, we are still a member of the WTO, and that's what's going to drive our trade relations, the rules and norms that we follow with the vast, vast majority of nations out there. That's assuming we don't quit the WTO. And, you know, you got to be careful about assumptions. But at any rate, so that's the WTO. And then you go down to the regional basis. So we have two regional agreements, multilateral agreements. One is NAFTA. So there's two countries that are lined up with us in NAFTA, Canada, Mexico. And the other one is Central America Free Trade Area and the Dominican Republic. So we got six more. And then you count up the other nations out there. There's 12 other nations out there that we have bilateral free trade agreements. So that's 20. 20 out of 164. So we haven't gone down this, you know, free trade agreement train very deep. So, you know, that's just part of the context, because we think about, wow, we got all these free trade agreements out there. No, we really don't, you know, with some few exceptions. And if you think about these bilateral agreements, with the exception of Korea, which was just signed a couple years ago, you know, these aren't major economies out there. You know, we've got Oman and Bahrain and Jordan. You know, I mean, they're not big players. But that's the current landscape. All right, so that's, you know, I showed you a bigger chart about our trade partners. Now let's look at how we're doing from the standpoint of the current account balance. And so that's the measure of our trade in goods and services. So you look at this chart here, and, you know, sort of the bottom line is this red dot. If you look at it overall, wow, we got about a $500 to $540 billion deficit. We do a lot worse than that when it comes to goods, and we do a whole heck of a lot better when it comes to services. We have a surplus when it comes to services. So that's about 3% of our gross domestic product. So that's how we're doing. And so when we think about moving forward in trade negotiations, this is this notion of these 21st century trade agreements. Now, this was the logo for the Trans-Pacific Partnership that used to be on the U.S. Trade Representative's website. It's not there anymore. Don't worry about it. It's not there anymore. However, this is still up here. This is still up here, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. That's not a signed agreement that, you know, that may or may not come into fruition. That's the U.S. and the EU. But this is sort of the outline of what we're looking for, comprehensive, high standard. Tariffs are already, because of the WTO, the average tariff on all the products, now average, you know, average is a tricky word there, but the average tariff on all products is about 5%. So tariffs are already rock bottom. So what we're really interested in is, okay, let's deal with these non-tariff barriers. And let's figure out how we can get more investment. Let's tackle intellectual property rights and services. Remember services, the previous chart? We do really good at services. So let's make sure this next set of agreements helps us out even more in services. So all of these kind of things, state-owned enterprises, and facilitate supply chains. That's sort of the trade agreements of the future. And well, the TPP, we can cross that out, but we've got several things going on that might move us forward in that direction. Okay, so not only has globalization impacted the strategic and the economic environment, it's also impacted what we think about manufacturers. So when we think about made in America, and so this is actually taken from the 1930 Tariff Act, that says if it's made in America, it's not a big deal. We know what's made in America. The manufactured product is assumed to have a single country of origin, and it's made there, and it's a binary thing. It either is or isn't made in America. Well, that's the way things used to be. Now we've got these things called global supply chains. So because of those four factors that I mentioned about globalization, transportation shipping costs decrease, information technology, trade agreements, and financial investment. Because of those things, we now have integrated global supply chains. So this little chart on the left-hand side tells you that 60% of all world trade is made up of intermediate products based on global supply chains. Manufacturing is now a commodity. It's been disaggregated. We have supply chains. And so that's led Tom Friedman in his book, The World is Flat. He came up with this concept of the Dell theory of conflict prevention. In his earlier book, The Lexus and the Olive Tree, he talked about the McDonald's theory of conflict prevention. But that went out the book because we sort of went to war with Serbia and there was a McDonald's in Belgrade, so that wasn't very good anymore. But now we've got the Dell theory of conflict prevention. And the argument is that as you look at these products that we are buying, and you figure out that the bits and pieces for this product are coming from a whole range of different nations, and they're being put together, and so no nation can afford to go to war, can afford to get into a conflict with other nations that are part of this global supply chain. And so there's another pundit on this particular point that talks about the mutual assured production. So if you recall in the nuclear age, it used to be mutual assured destruction. Now it's mutual assured production. And we just, you know, these countries just cannot afford to get into a conflictual relationship because of global supply chains. That I would argue that this is a genie that we cannot put back in the bottle. And so you just got to think your way through that one. Okay, so here's a quick example. The president, you know, last Friday, he was down in South Carolina. He was at the Boeing plant. He says, wow, you guys are doing great things. This is wonderful. This is exactly what we need to see happening in America. Well, by the way, large parts of that 787 are built elsewhere, shipped into the United States and put together in a 787. And then it shows why they did that, because they wanted to dispense with the risk. So here's a chart. You know, there are 10 different nations that show up on this chart. Just today, in today's Wall Street Journal, there is an article. It's the exact same, not exact same picture, but the exact same thought process. There's a picture of the Airbus, and they're talking about the Airbus manufacturing and production process. And it's the exact same thing. You've got an Airbus that's split apart, and they show you all these different countries that are providing pieces. There's also an article in today's New York Times that talks about the concern that Boeing's global supply chain has about some of this talk about trade restrictions. Now, this is the global supply chain in America. If we impose restrictions and it becomes more costly for Boeing to make airplanes. By the way, Boeing is the number one exporter, the value of its exports in the United States. So these planes, these 787s, it's a big deal. But if we impose greater cost on Boeing, Boeing becomes less competitive, Airbus takes off. If Boeing is less competitive, there are less contracts and less demand for their subcontractors, for their parts suppliers, and that's going to be less jobs for those subcontractors can support. So it's all tied together. It's a very complex system. All right, so three quick issues that we're going to talk about. Trade-related issues, foreign direct investment, trade deficits, and currency manipulation, currency fluctuations. And as you can imagine, our president doesn't like either one of them. So here's his tweet on Ford, talking about, hey, it's a good deal. Ford's not going to invest in Mexico. Here's trade deficits. The Chinese are terrible. They're robbing us blind. And then here's currency fluctuations, and we'll beat up again on China a little bit. Okay, so when we talk about foreign direct investment, a lot of it is going on. So when we think about this big uptick in trade that I showed you, this is sort of the same kind of graph. It looks very similar. Huge increase in investment overseas. Now, if you go to the bottom of the chart and you look up here, the upper bar graph, that's one of the big concerns about offshoring. So foreign direct investment is a two-way street. We do it, we invest in other countries, and other countries invest in the United States. By the way, the US is the number one recipient of foreign direct investment. And that's a lot of what's shown up here in this chart. We benefit tremendously by foreign direct investment that comes in the United States. And why do they want to do that? Because we're a great market. We got a good labor force. We got all this innovation and R&D. We got great educational programs. So people want to come to America. So now this foreign direct investment is either mergers and acquisitions. And granted, a lot of this is acquisitions. But some of it is greenfield. Some of it is where companies come in and they build a factory in America, hire American workers, and take advantage of that. So as you look at this bar chart, it shows that, yeah, there's a lot of offshoring going on, but that's starting to shift. And that's some of this argument that, oh, more companies are talking about moving between low-cost countries, but a lot of them are talking about bringing it back onshore. So, you know, there's a lot of anecdotal evidence out there, but you can see lots and lots of jobs in America depend on foreign direct investment. So here's another example. So this is earlier in the week. I heard on NPR, there's a story about Century Tires. So this is a Chinese tire manufacturer that's building a $530 million plant in South Carolina, gonna hire 1,000 workers. So FDI, foreign direct investment, it's a two-way street. So you just gotta keep that in mind. All right, trade deficits. Yeah, it's not a good news story, right? We got $500 billion in a trade deficit. So what are they doing? They're stealing our jobs. So hopefully you had a chance to read the article in the Great Decisions book. I mean, I think that's a really good article. He comes at some of these issues from a little bit different angle, different perspective, but I think that's what's really good about it. Okay, so trade deficits, they're the bad guys. These are the folks that have big trade surpluses with the United States, so they must be stealing our jobs. These are the only three in that whole list there that we have trade agreements with. So maybe it's not exactly trade agreements that's leading to that. So, and you know, the administration's talking about, well, maybe we're gonna account for this differently. And so I just throw this up here. You know, when you think about these accounting statistics, the author in the article does a pretty good job about saying, well, what is this gross domestic product anyway? How do they come up with that? So how do we figure out trade balance? How do we come up with that? So there's a lot of questioning going on about this is post-World War II statistical analysis or statistical frameworks versus how the world is actually operating. All right, so some things to think about in the trade deficit considerations. So part of this is this global value train, just what I was talking about. We don't know how to do it using the old statistical methods. They can't take account of this global supply chain, all these intermediate products. So we buy an iPad, we import an iPad from China, and you look on the back and it says made in China. So we say, oh, okay, $300. So that $300 all goes into the deficit column for the US vis-a-vis China. But when you think about it, China only gets maybe, you know, $15, $20, $30 of that. The rest of it are intermediate products that are coming in from other countries, some of it even from the United States. So that's what this notion is here, this double counting. So in reality, depending on the country, our bilateral trade deficit, that $500 billion that I talked about, could be 25%, maybe up to 50% less if we were accounting. And the World Trade Organization, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, they're all taking a look at that. The other thing to think about, there are lots of jobs. Just because we are importing $500 billion worth of stuff doesn't mean that we have lost $500 billion worth of jobs. Those imports bring in a lot of jobs in terms of, well, how do we transport it from the port to where it needs to go? How do we sell it? How do we maintain it? How do we do the service contracts and all that stuff, which all goes on in the United States? So the argument is 55 cents of every dollar of imports actually supports a service job associated with that product. And so then this stuff down below here, this is the standard economic theory argument. So we won't dwell on that too much, but it just says that, you know, really trade deficits don't have anything to do or don't have that much to do with trade. It's all about U.S. macroeconomic policy. And the flip side of the current account is the capital account. So when we have money coming into the United States, that's part of the capital account. If we have more money coming into the United States, which is a surplus in the capital account, we're going to do something with that money, and we're going to be buying stuff. And that turns out the flip side of that is money going out in the current account is a deficit. So the argument is that it's all about national savings versus domestic investment. We are a very, very low savings country. We don't save very much. You know, there's all kinds of articles about that. And now this population may not fit in that category, but overall, we are a very low savings country. And so that's part of this relationship. So there's lots of different ways to think about the deficit. All right, so let's talk about currency. This is a really critical topic, currency. And you could have a whole, you know, there could be next year's Great Decision book should have something about currency. So there's a lot of discussion about that, but let me just, you know, so this is a chart that I find really pretty interesting. You know, no one really knows what a currency should be worth in a relative sense. You know, the economist comes out with this Big Mac index, and they say, hey, you know, we're going to take a look at how much a Big Mac costs in all these different countries, and that's really going to tell us what the currency rate ought to be. But nobody, so this gives you fluctuations here. So the IMF says, yeah, you know, it could be, you know, which is the one down at the bottom, that's the Japanese yen. It could be 15% undervalued or 15% overvalued. It's a very complicated, complex issue. But we're concerned about currency manipulation. Big deal. It's not just the Chinese. You know, I showed you that Twitter, that tweet, I guess, from President or then candidate Trump, who talked about the Chinese as a currency manipulator. So here's the value of the yuan versus the dollar. It was held steady. People argue that back here from 2000 to 2005, it shouldn't have been held steady. It should have been appreciating. They were artificially holding down the value of your currency. Why do you do that? If the value of your currency goes up, then that means the cost to buy Chinese goods, because you've got to convert your dollars into yuan, is going to be higher. So those Chinese goods are going to cost you more. And as good consumers that we all are, we're not going to buy that expensive stuff. We're going to buy American-made stuff, or we're going to buy stuff from Malaysia, Thailand, or someplace else. But we're not going to buy, you know, so if they manipulate their currency, that's a bad thing. So what this chart shows, that in reality, from about 2005 on, the Chinese currency, now, you know, that's the tricky thing about currency rates. You know, this is sort of like an inverted scale here. So when it goes down, that actually means that that currency is appreciating, okay? So so the currency, the Chinese currency actually appreciated by 30%. That's a huge appreciation. And so another concern about it is, okay, as they were manipulating their currency back here, they were accumulating foreign currency reserves. You know, big topic, we can't get too deep into that. Maybe we'll do it Q&A. And so we're concerned about that. That has changed. Our argument has been with the Chinese, and everybody in reality, you ought to allow the market to determine the value of your currency. Market. The market's going to determine a fair value for your currency. So now, be careful what you ask for. Because the market has started, the Chinese are internationalizing their currency. So a lot of changes, a lot of reforms, and it's a lot of hiccups. But lately, the currency, based on the market, has been depreciating. So you got a depreciating currency. That means Chinese products are less expensive. So that actually tells you, oh my gosh, we're gonna import more of that stuff. But that's the market direction. So when you look at this chart over here, the reserves, the financial reserves are going down like $1 trillion in just a couple years. The Chinese have been trying to strengthen their currency. So they are manipulating their currency, but they're trying to keep it strong right now. They're not trying to keep it weak. So, you know, you got to be, this argument, and so this is our new Treasury Secretary, and he just valid comment that he wants the IMF to police exchange rates. But we're sort of fighting the last war. So currency markets are very dynamic. Okay, so we put out this report, the Treasury Department. This was Secretary Mnuchin's predecessor, Secretary Liu, and we put out this report twice a year, the Treasury Department does, because Congress told them they have to do it. And they say, okay, you gotta tell us who the currency manipulators are, the bad folks out there. And they've argued that, you know, China's really doing pretty good right now. Our biggest concern is with Germany, but that's a whole nother issue because they don't really own their currency anyway. They're under the euro, and we might be able to come back to that if there are questions on there. So they say nobody is manipulating their rate of exchange. And we certainly wouldn't do that. We wouldn't manipulate the dollar, right? No way. So you look at this chart over on the left-hand side here. So our Federal Reserve, for very valid domestic reasons, the monetary policy has been to try to keep our interest rates low to encourage economic activity. So we've been involved with quantitative easing. Now, we haven't been doing that for a number of years, but there are like three or four different phases of quantitative easing. So you look at that chart earlier of the Chinese increase in financial reserves, which people say is a bad thing, and then you look at this chart of the Fed's increase of their balance sheet, they look pretty similar. So you gotta be careful about, you know, who is a currency manipulator. Because when this was going on, the Brazilians and the Germans and lots of people complained that we were instigating a currency war. So, you know, the eye of the beholder can be a little bit different depending where you sit. So that's currency. And oh, by the way, this is why this topic is really important. The dollar has gone up dramatically over the last couple years. So as we are trying to adjust our current account balance, get that $500 billion deficit to, you know, maybe a couple hundred billion or maybe less than that, it's hard to do when your currency is appreciating, or it's harder to do. So here's the paradox. If we have, and we'll talk about the economic policies that the president has proposed, as our economy gets stronger, our dollar is probably going to get stronger. So we want our economy to get stronger, but that's going to put pressure on the dollar. The dollar goes up, that's going to put even more pressure on our trade account. It's a little tricky. It's a little hard. Okay, jobs. Let's talk about jobs. So here's your GPS. Globalization positioning system tells you exactly where your job is. All right, so unemployment rate. Not too shabby right now. 4.8%. They said the beginning of this week, and I gave these charts to Mary, yesterday morning, and you know, because there's just so much stuff coming in. This changes all the time. But the beginning of this week, they said the claims for unemployment insurance have hit the lowest level they've been in like 20 years. So unemployment rate's pretty good. All right, so let's shred that a little bit and figure out the sectors that it's in. So look on the right-hand side of this chart. You know, there's a big dip here. for all these different sectors, that's 2008. 2008 financial crisis followed by the Great Recession. So everybody was losing jobs here, just about. But if you look at the uptick, it's the services, education, health services, leisure, hospitality, professional and business, financial activities, transportation. Construction is finally starting to have a little bit of an uptick. And then manufacturing's down here at the bottom. So manufacturing, that's what we're going to talk about. That's the problem. And then you look at the chart on the left. So that aggregates that employment a little bit differently. And I think it really paints a pretty clear picture. You know, our agricultural industry is great. We don't have to worry about making that great again. It is great. But it doesn't employ anybody because they don't need people because they're so, so productive. But we are doing, you know, we're just turning out bountiful harvest after, you know, assuming that Mother Nature cooperates. Manufacturing is down. By the way, manufacturing employment is down for essentially everybody. All the Western nations, Europe, Japan, even China, the percent of manufacturing jobs has gone down. And the author does a pretty good job talking about that. What's gone up? Services. So that's why the title of this chart is we are in a post-industrial economy. Industry's not the driver anymore that it used to be. Industry's still important, but it's not the big driver. Now, that doesn't mean we don't worry about it, but that's just how it is. Okay, so now you look at this. This is another big myth out there that we don't make anything in America anymore. And sometimes, you know, when I go with my wife clothes shopping, which is always one of my wonderful hobbies, she'll be in the dressing room and I'll go around and I'll look at all the tags. I'm looking for one of those Made in America tags. And occasionally, it's like, wow, there is something made in America, you know, clothing, apparel, but not very much. But we make a lot of stuff, and that's the top of this chart shows that we are making more now than we were back in 1980. Lots more. So the productivity of our industrial sector has skyrocketed. But we're making lots more. We're the number two manufacturer in the world. It was 2010 when the Chinese overtook us. Not until 2010 did the Chinese overtake us. There's a report that I just saw that came out from Deloitte and Touche that argues on a global competitive basis. It forecasts to 2020, and it says by 2020, America's going to be number one again. Now, you know, it's a forecast, so you don't know. But at least, you know, we're in this race. We are making a lot, but we're doing it with a lot less workers. A lot less workers are making more and more. So that you go back to the agricultural industry. We're just producing all kinds of food, but we're doing it with a lot less workers. So manufacturing, I thought this was pretty interesting. Here we're talking about manufacturing. This is a congressional research report that came out in February, a couple weeks ago. It says, well, what is it? You know, we're concerned about what the heck is manufacturing? And there's a big argument about that. So George Washington says, yeah, we need to do this. Require that we should promote such manufacturers as tend to render them independent of others for essential, particularly military supplies. And the president says, we're going to bring the jobs back. The president met yesterday with a group of CEOs in the White House. And the argument was, we're bringing the jobs back. That's what's going to drive our economy. So this was in today's New York Times. Everything's going to be based on bringing our jobs back, the good jobs, the real jobs. They've left and they're coming back and they have to come back. So we're really concerned about manufacturing. All right, so this next chart is a little busy. Not that any of the other ones weren't busy, but this is a little busy. So the argument is there's two basic fundamental claims about trade and manufacturing. The first one I already talked about is that a good is made in one country. And this is the second one. It's that wherever that stuff is transformed into a finished product, that's manufacturing. So we think of manufacturing as bending the metal, pounding the steel, putting the thing together. But in reality, there's a whole lot of other stuff. So this is the infamous smiley curve down here at the bottom on the left side. There's a whole lot of other stuff that goes on in the manufacturing process. And so that's this smiley curve. And the smile is that on the upper ends of the smile, that's where the real value is. in the brand, in the design, in the engineering, and then at the tail end, in the sales and the service contracts. Down here at the bottom, actually manufacturing, putting it together, the assembly of the product, that's the low value at the bottom of the smiley curve. Well, all of these other things, the way manufacturing used to happen, they were always included in the manufacturing process, but they were all included in the same building. So I recall watching this PBS special about Henry Ford, and I forget the name of the plant. He built this huge, huge plant in Michigan that started from the iron ore all the way, and it spit out Model Ts on the other end. And then all the design, all the marketing, all those folks were under one building. So guess what? The statistics said all of those services, that's all part of manufacturing. So because it's in the same building, it's all part of that transformation process, they all count. But now what do we do today? Today, we take a lot of these services and we outsource them. We have other design teams that do it. We do the design work in America and we have it assembled in China. Or we do the design work in, you know, for Nike sneakers in Portland, but the Vietnamese actually make the sneakers. So the guys that are working in Portland, well, they're not manufacturers. They're services. And so this little chart at the upper end here on the left side, that shows you the percentage of service folks that are involved in the manufacturing process, which we used to count as manufacturing, and now we largely don't. So the bottom line of all this big dissertation here is down here below, right there at the bottom. So this Brookings study says that, you know, manufacturing-related employment, instead of being about 11 to 12 million, is really closer to 32, 33 million. Okay, so that's when you get into these statistics. Global supply chains, disaggregated production, it's all different. So what looks to be pretty bleak may not be that bleak. So that's just part of the bottom line of this particular story. Vacancies, we're concerned about jobs. We want to bring the jobs back. So look at the top quote here on this chart, right below vacancies. The problem isn't too many workers who can't find jobs, it's too many jobs that can't find workers. We hit a 15-year high this year in the number of job announcements for manufacturing jobs. So that's, and we're gonna come to that. This is a big issue, I think, for us. Okay, so a lot of it has to deal with the skills. What are the kind of skills we need? So not only is the manufacturing process changing, but this automation, that's why we are still producing a tremendous amount of stuff, but we're doing it with fewer and fewer workers. So this is the automation, you know, these are the real aliens we need to worry about, the robots. So there's the president of the IMF saying, hey, it's automation, it's robots that are taking the jobs. This is former President Obama's farewell address. The next wave of economic dislocations won't come from overseas, it's gonna come from the relentless pace of automation that takes a lot of good middle-class jobs. This is the third industrial revolution. People are talking about this adaptive manufacturing, 3D printing, cheaper robots, automation, collaborative manufacturing, all of that's coming. They say, this one analyst says that the factory of the future is gonna have two employees. It's gonna be a man and a dog. And the man is there to feed the dog, and the dog is there to keep the man away from the machines. So I don't know. I mean, okay, I got it. A little bit of a stretch, but that's what we're looking at here. So here is three quick examples, and one is from January. The other two are from, you know, less than a week, you know, this week. Pretty fascinating. So Adidas, you know, says we're going to come up with this, what is it, speed factories. We're going to create a speed factory in Atlanta, Georgia, to address the U.S. market, and we're going to put one in Ansbach, Germany, for the European market, and we're gonna make sneakers, trainers, in those two countries. Where are they made now? I mean, they're made in Vietnam, Malaysia, Philippines, Bangladesh, I mean, you know, or perhaps Nicaragua, but they're not made in Western countries. So they're gonna create these speed factories, and they're gonna turn out 500,000 each factory, 500,000 pairs of trainers. That sounds like a lot. Of course, Adidas makes 300 million of them, but that's another story. But the bottom line is, we're going to do this with 3D printers, digital design, and it's going to take 160 jobs instead of 1,000 if we did that same factory in Asia because of all that adaptive manufacturing. Next story. We're talking about, wow, this oil revolution is huge, and it is a big deal. The oil revolution or the energy revolution, oil, natural gas, all that stuff, huge deal for the United States. And so this is a fascinating article talking about, you know, the Texas oil fields are on the rebound. So oil prices, energy prices have just started to tick up, you know, about $53 a barrel. So now we're going to start to ramp up our production again. Well, in the law, when the prices dipped down to 30, whatever it was, dollars a barrel, you know, they couldn't afford to produce, even with fracking. But they got smart. This is business. This is our industry. And they reduced cost and they reduced jobs. But the jobs are left behind. So now we can produce energy in the United States and make money at $35 a barrel. And it's all automated. They say it's like we do the deep sea oil. Well, you know, you're not putting frogmen down there to do this stuff. So it's all automated. They have captured that technology and they're using it on land. And then the last example, let's go back to Boeing again. This is satellites. So this is just a couple days ago. We're going to do a better, quicker, safer job building satellites with a lot fewer workers. 3D manufacturing, 3D printing, all that kind of stuff. So that's the wave of the future. And here's the bottom line on these jobs. You know, there's a lot of manufacturing jobs available if you have the right skills. 32.2% increase in manufacturing jobs if you have a higher degree. 17% if you have an associate's degree. If you don't, if you're down here where all those people used to be. You know, how many of you know the movie Rudy? Wow, what a great movie. I love that movie. Okay, so people are going off to the steel mill. They don't need to go to college. They just come out of high school and we go to the steel mill. And we get a great job. Not so fast anymore. So this is a big issue, something to think about. You know, learning, earning, the elephant in the truck. How do we retrain? How do we reskill these folks? That's the big issue. Okay, politics. Let's talk politics. TPP is gone, bulldozed. I was sort of hoping he'd hang in there a little bit and maybe think about it, but it didn't happen. But you know, we are the number one trading nation in the world. But you wouldn't guess it if you think about our politics. None of this is new. So you go back to 1992. So this is Clinton, Perot, and Bush. You know, the giant sucking sound from NAFTA. You go to 2008. So this is the last big primary election in the 2008 campaign right here in Pennsylvania. The last time until November that Pennsylvania really mattered. And it really mattered in November. And so this was an advertisement in the Pennsylvania papers. China cheats. Pennsylvania loses. So that's the big argument in 2008 between Obama and Clinton. And they didn't like NAFTA either. So then you get to 2012, and Romney and Obama, they're talking about currency manipulation, and we know all about the recent election in 2016. But this is even last week. Bernie Sanders is still out there fighting for good jobs and to keep jobs in America. So that's our politics, even though we are the number one trading nation in the world. So what's driving it? So I would argue that this is the big issue, is that top notion there, inequality. We've got, you know, you go back to there's winners and losers. Well, the winners are winning pretty significantly. If you're in the upper income brackets and you already have some wealth, you're accumulating even more and more wealth. And if you're not, and you're down in the middle class or the lower class, you're getting less and less of what potentially is your fair share. I don't know about fair, but your share. So this rising inequality. So this book that came out, Capital, in 2014, I mean, that was a huge hit. And this is his argument. You know, the main driver of inequality. So the capital accumulates more, the returns to economic growth, and it generates extreme inequalities that stir discontent and undermine democratic values. Big deal, inequality. And so then that drives this push for populism and anti-globalization. So this was the January-February Foreign Affairs, The Power of Populism. This book, The Globalization Paradox, is not necessarily new, but this Danny Roderick's been arguing for a number of years. So the subtitle is Why Global Markets, States, and Democracy Can't Coexist. I mean, think about it. I mean, that's the problem. And so here's this is from Paul Krugman, a pretty well-known Nobel Prize-winning economist, regular commentator for the New York Times, and here's what he says. You know, much of the elite defense of globalization has been basically dishonest, false claims, all this kind of stuff, hand-waving over the large distributional effects. So what he's saying there, the distributional effects, the people at the top are winning from globalization, the people at the bottom are not. The theory is that, oh, well, the winners can compensate the losers, the distributional effects. And so that's part of this argument here is that's not really happening. So the elite case for ever freer trade is largely a scam. Wow. So that's the voting, and then you get this argument, you know, in the New York Times, or the Economist recently that talks about the white working class males, and that their unemployment rate is actually higher than everybody else's, and that their education, if you don't have the educational background, you know, your participation in the labor force is gonna be down, that wage growth is down, inequality and being disadvantaged. So now you go all the way back to that chart I was talking about with Cordell Hull and how we think about the world. So this is this great divide today is not so much left and right. It's are we going to be an open, welcoming economy or a closed keep out? Are we going to be market liberal economy or are we going to be neo-mercantilist? And so you go halfway down there and you get this international policy, free trade versus managed trade, outcome. Is it going to be harmonious win-win, or is it going to be conflictual zero-sum? So I think that's why now we're really into this international realm. Okay, I've got to speed through this a little bit. Here's what the president says he wants to do. I just read the quote from the New York Times from today. He's going to increase the GDP rate. He's going to do all these things, and he's going to tackle these different things for trade. And believe me, we're going to have a lot of trade deals, but they're going to be one-on-one. There won't be a whole big mash pot. Okay, so Trans-Pacific Partnership. I'll run through a couple of these. The TPP is dead. It's been bulldozed, as I showed you earlier. That's what he says. That's what the president said about the TPP. It really was a pretty good deal. And you think about it, I mean, most of these little nations here are in reality, in the grand scheme of things, are sort of piddly trading nations. I hope there's nobody in the audience here from any of those countries, but, you know, with the exception of Japan, and there's a lot of good things about it. Geostrategic impact was huge, but we're moving on. However, I think there's the potential that the outcome, you know, we negotiated with Japan as part of the TPP, so we've sort of already hashed this out, so perhaps this recent Gulf diplomacy is going to create maybe a U.S.-Japan free trade. So there is the potential that we get a big, huge benefit. Japan's the number four economy in the world. So that's a pretty good deal. Okay, NAFTA, we don't like NAFTA. So we're concerned about, you know, we're gonna tear it up. It's a terrible agreement. We're gonna, you know, because we got this huge deficit. By the way, coming in here, the Secretary of State and Secretary for Homeland Security have been down in Mexico. And I just heard that the Mexicans have agreed to not only build a wall, but pay for it. And here it is. Yes, this is their negotiating position. You go back to the boundary of 1824 and we're all in. All right, so we're gonna move on from there. So NAFTA is a good deal. This is this global supply chain. All these kind of jobs are based on NAFTA. So there's some things, there might be some rough edges, but the integrated, you know, 40% of everything that we get from Mexico is actually made in the United States anyway. And it creates democratic stability in our southern neighbors. So that's really very important. I think we can probably work this out. You know, these are a couple points. Hopefully you can read those when the Prime Minister of Canada was down here just very recently. Some things to do. Canada and Mexico were part of the TPP. So they were part of that negotiation. So a lot of that hard work has already been done. And in fact, you know, you see the second bullet here, toughen the rules of origin. So, you know, maybe right now the rule is 62.5% of components have to be made in North America. And the Mexicans and the Canadians said, yeah, okay, we can toughen that. They agreed to that in TPP. So perhaps this might not be as bad as it appears. And we gotta recognize that this North American manufacturing region is really very strong, very, very competitive. Okay, China. We don't like China. There's a trade imbalance. It's huge. Lots of problems there. This is the guy that's going to help us out so you get an idea of where he's coming from. Peter Navarro, an economist from California, those are his two recent books, The Coming China Wars and Death by China. So I wonder what his perspective is on this. But at any rate, so this is, I think this is pretty good analysis. We're not going to go any deeper than this, but this is this notion of responsible hardball. We ought to be playing hardball with the Chinese. And I think this is a pretty good list of some things that we ought to do. Avoid mixing trade and geopolitics. Focus on real abuses. You know, don't shoot ourselves in the foot. And so here are some of the things that we can do and we have some leverage over. This investment reciprocity, this market status. When China joined the WTO, they came in under a non-market economy. And there's a lot of implications of that. And the rule was in 15 years, so that's last December, December 2016, they were supposed to be declared a market economy. But the US and the EU both said, oh, but we got some wiggle room there, and neither one of us has declared them a market economy. So that helps us when we try to say that they're doing bad things in the global economy. So we've got some leverage there. We're working on this bilateral investment treaty, and I already talked about currency manipulation. And by the way, the Chinese economy is really very shaky. You know, if you want to be president of a country out there, I'd much rather be president of the United States than China. Okay, so trade war, there's a lot of talk about trade war. Our recently approved Secretary of Commerce says, hey, it didn't work so well in the 1930s, and we're not going to really make it happen again this year. And so there's just some concerns down here at the bottom about how the trade war would play out. As you would imagine, the president of the IMF says, don't be a protectionist, that's a bad thing. These are some things that could happen globally. I mean, we got a globally integrated economy now. So if we adopt poor policies, it's going to have a global impact. If there's a global impact, it's going to come back and smack us as well. So we ought to think geoeconomically. We ought to be concerned about our economic instruments and what our policies are. This is not zero sum. It can be a win-win. And there are significant strategic implications of economic relations. So when we think globally, economically, it's not just about the bottom line. The bottom line's important, but it's not just about the bottom line. This is our vice president. Let's see if it shows up. Now, I don't know where it's governor, so I didn't have a date on this, so I don't exactly sure. But you know, trade means jobs, but trade also means security. We have done a lot of security cooperation with Mexico, based on crime, on security issues, anti-terrorism, and I don't think we want that to go out the window. So there's our U.S. policy. We got the new poker player out here. It could go bad at the top, the three bullets, but it shouldn't. There's a lot of things that we ought to work on, and we just ought to focus on the fundamental strength of our economy, which is really very good. You know, we got top R&D spending. Innovation is number one in the United States. The energy thing is huge. Education, our secondary education is the best in the world. We got to work on our primary education a little bit. TAA, trade adjustment assistance, is something that we need to, that's the winners compensating the losers. And so we got to do better at that and some of these other kind of things here. So here's the big challenge for society. I mentioned this before, so you can just read through that. And I don't know the answer to this. I'm sure we probably have a lot of educators out here in the group. But I think this is huge, how we deal with those folks in our society that don't have the skills. How do we address it? How do we get them the skills? Because if they don't have them, it's going to be really hard for them to find a spot in this economy as we go forward. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Mike, and he's going to put you on break, and then we'll have a discussion.
Robert Gordon, his recent book, The Rise and Fall of American Growth. I'm surprised you didn't refer to that in this.
I think I had a little bit too much material anyway, but okay, all right. I should add more. I know. I should jam more in there. Yeah, go ahead.
His thesis is that from 1870 to 1940, innovation, discovery, and everything in the United States just skyrocketed. Since 1940, after World War II, we've basically been going down. The rate of invention, the growth in terms of our ability to build the capacity to build wealth has gone down. Whether you agree with that, and where do you see that for us? It seems like 3D printing, you get 1,000 machines inside of a factory manufacturing parts where you don't need people anymore. It seems like, labor is going out of the picture instead of being included in the picture.
Well, that's a great question. All of the major economies of the world, they're all interested about innovation. The Chinese talk about indigenous innovation. The Chinese recognize, you go back to that smiley curve. They recognize that, they're just down there at the bottom of the smile. They're just, banging metal together, and that's not going to get them ahead. So they want to be designers. They want to create brands and all this. So they want to get up there. They want to be an innovative economy. And so that's why they're buying up a lot of technology. That's why they're doing a lot of things that ruffle our feathers. I don't know. I mean, so part of the answer to your question is, well, what's the next big thing? And how do we get into that? And how do we continue to support that? So there's a lot of this information technology, and I know there's a lot of writing out there that we had the big dot-com bubble, and there's a lot of emphasis on IT, but did we really get, and I think this is part of Gordon's comment, did we really get the bang for the buck out of that? Have we been able to translate those kind of technologies into production methods and higher productivity and all that other kind of stuff? And I don't know. I'm not an industrial engineer or organization type person, but I think it's coming. I mean, I think it's coming, and I think that's reflected to a certain extent in some of those charts I did put out there, that the workforce of the future is going to have to be different than the present day's workforce, particularly when it comes to what we call manufacturing. I mean, service industries are still going to be out there, but even in service industries, I mean, you're going to have to know how to write code, or you're going to have to know how to deal with code and deal with the information technology and all that kind of stuff. You're going to have to be out there. But for manufacturing, I mean, it's just going to be a different skill set. That's why it's interesting. It's not, reskilling is what they're talking about. And it's retraining programs. And that's part of the big rub. If you were a steel worker in Pittsburgh or wherever it happens to be, and we said, yeah, they're coming back, I don't know. You could be a 40, 50-year-old person that, knew what those skills were, but it's like, are we going to be able to retrain you? Are we going to be able to get you into a different job? The other impact of that, we always used to talk about one of the big advantages of the U.S. economy was the mobility of our workforce. So if you lose a job in, Northeast Pennsylvania, no big deal. You're going to pick up shop and you're going to move to North Carolina. Or better yet, you're going to go all the way across country to California where the jobs are and all that kind of stuff. So there's still some of that mobility out there. But one of the impacts of the global financial crisis and the impact on the housing market, and people are starting to recognize this more. So some of that is Stiglitz and some of that is some of these other writers. They're saying, wow, it's a lot harder for people to uproot and go than what we thought it was. I mean, whether it's community, whether it's, you know, you really can't afford to sell your house and move someplace else. The skill set that you have, I mean, it's much, much harder to do. And that's why there's a lot of this, that's part of this populism, that people are upset about, you know, sort of being on the losing side of this equation. I don't know where we go in the future. I mean, if you could figure that out, that's, you know, particularly people with grandkids. You know, I got a couple grandkids, and, you know, thankfully now they're just into the kindergarten stage. So I got a couple years to be able to figure out where to say, you know, you ought to be thinking about this field. Probably what's going to happen by the time in another 10, 11 years when they're ready to go to college, the fields that they should go into, we don't even know about today. I mean, the technology is moving. We had this guy a couple weeks ago at one of these seminars. He was a futurist. And his future framework was only out about 15 to 20 years, not that far out. And he's talking about, you know, I mentioned we've gone from an industrial economy to a service-based economy. He says the next thing, and it's going to be here in 15 to 20 years, is the experience-based economy. The people are going to be selling experiences. And you can see just a little glimmer of that when, you know, it's sort of like the experience you get on a cruise ship. We're going to sell you an experience. It's got all this stuff. So, but that's what, and it's this virtual reality or this blended reality. So now the technology that's involved in that, I don't know. I didn't grow up with video games, and thankfully I didn't watch my kids when they played video games. But so I don't know. It's going to be hard. Yes, sir.
Thanks for a great presentation. My head has just stopped spinning from getting an entire semester of macroeconomics in 60 minutes. I want you to help me read the newspaper, or rather, I want you to help me understand the newspapers. If you accept Half's argument that classic economics, as discussed by Ricardo, the metrics of that are passé, what's the new metric? What should we be looking for when we read Friedman, when we read Will, when we read the upshot in the New York Times? What should we be looking for as opposed to GNP, GDP, which, according to Half, are no longer relevant?
You know, it's another great question. Where's my economist? Is she still in the room over there? Okay, come up front. No. I found Hef's argument very good. In fact, I was so intrigued by it. You know, I went out and I said, okay, I got to buy his book. You know, so I got his book, and I didn't get it finished yet before the presentation. But actually, I was a little disappointed at the end anyway. But that's neither here nor there. I found his presentation very good, and that's what I said earlier, a slightly different perspective. I'm not sure that I buy into to his issue with GDP. Now, I know there's a lot of discussions out there that, you know, there's a lot of things about gross domestic product. So there's a lot of debate out there about how do we calculate it. You know, in fact, there was a woman up here that was talking about some of the statistics. You know, okay, how do we really figure it out? And are we capturing all this e-commerce? And are we doing, and then some of the trade stuff. I mean, how do we capture these intermediate products and the global supply? You know, how do we capture that in GDP? So there's a lot of discussion about that. There's a lot of discussion, is it the right thing? I mean, you know, is it gross domestic product, or is there some way that we should give credit for, you know, like the quality of life? So maybe the GDP is not that high in Sweden, but they're just living life and they're loving it up there. So how do we capture that? And even some of the other European states have talked about that. You know, how do we capture, because it's not really in the GDP numbers, but how do we capture some of this education that goes on? And, you know, you just, this notion of lifelong learning. I mean, how do you, so there's that notion. And so, okay, I got it. We need to continue to look at, you know, coming up with a better measure. And so Haft goes with this, the national wealth. And I think that's an interesting perspective. And so if you think about it, you know, whatever, I forget the U.S., you know, like $75 trillion, you know, and wow, you know, versus China's down there at maybe 10 or 12 total trillion. So it's like they're not even close. And I think that's an interesting way to think about it, because to a large extent, I think that's true. You know, we sort of get that in the defense budget. You know, I'm in a defense business. And so we look at our defense budget and we say, wow, you know, we look over at our shoulder and say, boy, the Chinese are, you know, they're spending more and more per year for defense and they're creeping up. I mean, they're not really close to us yet. But another thing to think about, okay, they're spending more, but man, we got this capital stock that's huge. We got any Navy folks in here? You know, just think about our U.S. Navy. You know, we're not buying that every year, but that's a capital stock out there that's huge. So I think there's some argument to that, but if you're going to compare economies and you're going to think about how they're doing in a relative sense, and it's sort of like the potential. So that's why I think there's some value to GDP and the GDP growth rate, because the growth rate sort of gives you an idea. And I know it's, and then you start talking about statistics, and everybody says the Chinese statistics aren't worth the paper they're printed off. And there's a lot of recent stuff out there now saying that, you know, you got to really be wary about what you're reading. And, you know, maybe some of ours are a little shaky too. But just to have some type of system that allows you to compare, I think there's value in that. And I think the growth is good. I mean, you know, if you think about the potential for a country to do things that it needs to do. So whether that's to support a defense budget, whether that's to support an education budget, whether that's to fund infrastructure, or provide health care, whatever it is. I mean, that's sort of based on the wealth generating capacity of your society, because that's what you're going to tax and that's what you're going to tap into. And so I guess that's more tied to this notion of GDP. But it's another one of these complex, and I'm not giving you a good answer, I know it, but it's another one of these complex issues. And that's why, you know, they're looking at all these kind of things. And my solace is that there are enough economists out there that are sticking with the tried and true. And so I don't have to, at this point in my life, I don't have to branch out too far, but... So that's my shot at it, you know, as imperfect as that is. Yes,
Good afternoon. My name is Yomara Alvarez, and one of our military assignments as a family was in Europe. I'm not going to specify the place, but when we got there, the what we call U.S. Mint, or the money, was changed. And it skyrocketed the economy from the different countries, except the ones that are analyzing and waking up, like New England, with the, how you call it, Brexit.
Yes. Brexit.
So for the people that don't know, basically when we were in Europe, $2, it was basically turning to the size of a US quarter. So when you go to the supermarket and you wanted to pay cash, it was this size. So it's easy for coins to get loose and then increase maybe the GDP. I'm thinking that everybody knows that only credit card transactions are the ones registering the GDP or gross domestic product. Cash transactions are not registered. So that's why our President Donald Trump called the cash transactions illegal, because they're not registering the GDP, and that's why there are so many poor countries. Now, my question to you is, do you think it will be beneficial if the U.S. Mint was modified physically to make it more valuable? Will it increase the value of it or no?
Well, I mean, it's an interesting question. It's not an area that I know a whole lot about. But you know, one of the things that you bring up is that we are transitioning more and more to a cashless economy, and so how do you operate in a cashless economy? And I think we're moving. You know, this is another one of these things back to the innovation question and what the world's going to be like in another 10 or 15 years. I think another 10 or 15 years, you know, whether it's your smartphone or whatever, that your smartphone is going to be your it's going to be everything. You know, that's going to be your cash. It's going to be your wallet. It's going to, you know, so you're not going to have any cash at all, probably. And maybe you won't even have a smartphone. Maybe you have a little chip that's in your hand or something. I don't know. Yeah. No, yeah. So there's been a lot of discussion about should we get rid of the penny, you know, because it costs us more money to make pennies than what the pennies are worth. Or maybe there's more worth, you know, there's more in the little bit of copper that's left in there than what the penny. And I don't know. I mean, you can probably make some efficiencies there, but you know, we are a very traditionalist economy, and it's like, oh, you can't get rid of the penny. Yeah, I'm not sure why. I mean, the only thing they're good for is to save up for your grandkids to come in and put into penny wrappers, and then, you know, they get a big kick out of it. So, but you know, there are some efficiencies, I'm sure, that we could make when it comes to, you know, currency, or just the physical nature of our currency. The big thing we're trying to do now with our currency is to make it harder to counterfeit. Because we're not completely at a cashless economy. And that's the other thing that's been going on, both here with the euro. We're trying to get rid of the big dollar denominations. So I think the 500 euro bill is gone or is going. There's a lot of discussion that we're going to get rid of the $100 bill because those things are really handy for the cash-based economy, criminal activities in terms of these bundles of money. So there's a lot of activity out there for currency. So it's an interesting field to look into. Yes, sir.
Thank you for a fantastically exciting presentation. Interestingly, there is a show playing this weekend at Gamut Theater in Harrisburg called RUR, deals very, very nicely with this question of robots' impact on society. I recommend it highly, very Great. Well done. But my question is, your presentation, one time after another, spelled complexity. What impact, if the complexity of this concept is beyond the ken of a simplistic perspective, and then what happens when that simplistic perspective extends all the way up the political hierarchy?
Okay, you know, I'm still a government employee, you know. And I know this is being taped, so no. So I did put a disclaimer out there, but you know, that was the other answer I was gonna say, I don't know, just stay tuned and we'll see. No, I mean that's another great question. So you think about these kind of things, and you know, there's another, like I said, this is so current, and it's just hard to stay, you know. There's a great editorial in today's Wall Street Journal, the back of the back page. Got a great picture there. And so it's by this, I guess he was the chief, he's retired, recently retired chief operating officer or chief financial officer of Caterpillar. And so he's making the claim. Remember I said that just yesterday the president met in the White House with all these CEOs and they're talking about jobs. How do we bring jobs back? And they had a bunch of quotes in there from, you know, GE, Lockheed Martin, Boeing, a whole bunch of different CEOs this is great. We have a chance to talk to the president. Well, so the editorial today in the Wall Street Journal says, hey, industry, when are we going to wake up and start making the argument that if we wall ourselves off, if we go down this protectionist route, we're gonna be in trouble. I mean, he makes the comment, he says, I've sat in hundreds of meetings, you know, at Caterpillar, and we talk about, you know, how we're gonna, you know, increase productivity, how we're gonna make, you know, more sales in this market, how are we gonna, you know, get the commodities that we need, how we're gonna design new products and all these kind of things. He says, I've never sat in a market or never sat in a meeting that says, well, how do we keep jobs in America? Now, I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but you know, from the perspective of business, it's like, what are we about? And so I think one of the strengths of America, you know, that next to last chart, you know, our business community, we are business people. We do good, we can compete. This is a system that we made. And so we, you know, to a certain extent, we ought to stop whining about some of this stuff and get on with it. But there's got to be leadership. You know, there's somebody, and that's one of my personal disappointments when you think about these kind of issues, was with the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So, you know, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, okay, that's a trade deal. But what it really was, in my view, I mean, it was really a geostrategic arrangement to support our important interest in the Western Pacific vis-a-vis China. Now, we're doing that. It's geoeconomics. We're using economic stuff to help us work geopolitical type arrangements. Now, there's some economics in there, too. I mean, it's pretty amazing to think that we've had this tremendous relationship with the Japanese economy ever since World War II, but no free trade agreement. So we finally were able to hammer one out, which would have been pretty significant in itself. But it was the strategic reason, but it was not just now President Trump. I mean, as I showed in the chart, it was everybody. I mean, the major candidates. So it wouldn't have mattered what happened in November. TPP was probably dead. Although, you know, I've got a friend that I've worked with in the United States Trade Representative's office. He's one of the deputy negotiators for the TPP. And so he was making the argument. He said, you know, every president that comes into office, you know, lately, and I showed that chart as well, you know, has sort of been down on trade. But once they get in office, you know, they've been elected, so they, you know, they fought off that battle. And then you start thinking about it, or for whatever reasons, you know, they sort of changed their position, and, you know, because Clinton wasn't a real strong supporter of NAFTA, but we went with NAFTA. You know, surely President Obama was not a strong supporter of any of this trade stuff. I mean, you can go back and look at some of his pronouncements in the campaign and in the early years. It's not a whole lot different than what we're hearing now. But he changed his mind. My complaint about President Obama in that respect is he waited too long. He waited too long, and it was too late. We were already in the 2016 election cycle when we finally hammered out TP. You know, it's very hard to do to get these negotiations done, but he waited too long. And so you need somebody that's going to make the argument. And so, you know, that's the dilemma we're in. Who's that somebody out there? I mean, you look at, I showed that chart about what the divide is. You know, it's almost like from a political perspective in the United States, you know, the politicians are all lined up on the left side of that divide. No, it's the right side. They're all lined up on the right side of the divide, which was the closed side. Nobody's really talking about, man, it's really valuable for us to be a trader, to be integrated. Now that's the good side. That's the upside of trade. But you know, okay, we got to take care of the downside too. You know, we got to really look at that. And that's, you know, it's pretty hard in our country to do stuff like that because we don't want to tax anybody anymore, and we're not willing to pay the bill out there. Well, I shouldn't say we don't want to tax anybody. We all pay a lot in taxes, but it's just how we allocate that to take care of those people that either need more education or whatever. I mean, there are some really amazing projections when people look at the, let me, one more point and then I'll get to the next question. When people look to the future and, you know, you look at a country like Japan. So I didn't talk about demographics. I had a whole section I was going to do immigration. But, you know, guess what? I didn't have enough time to get that in. I took Gordon's book. I couldn't do immigration and demographics. But when you look at some of that stuff, and you look at a country like Japan, and you say, wow, Japan, they're hurting demographically. I mean, they are getting older. They're not even close to a replacement birth rate. What are they going to do for workers? And then you think, well, in this new economy, maybe they don't need workers because they got robots. So in fact, Japan might be in a pretty good position because they got robots to do the work, and because they don't have younger people competing with robots, they don't have to worry about where are we going to find jobs for the younger people. So you think about that. You try to get your arms around that. And so there's a concern now that as we become more and more automated, and yeah, we got the service economy, so that's going out there. But even some of that stuff, I mean, you know, if you noted the picture of the robot, you know, it was a robot holding a kid's hand, you know, providing daycare. And then there was a robot up there providing sort of senior care and all that kind of stuff. So one of the concerns that people are thinking about, as we become more and more automated, what are we going to have people do? So Switzerland, not that long ago, had a debate and a vote in Switzerland. And it says, okay, the proposition is that we need to provide everybody a basic income level. Sort of like a universal income, so that you may not have a job, but we're going to give you money so you can, you know, you can be engaged in the economy. You can be buying stuff in the economy because we want your demand signal in the economy, but we just know that you're not going to, you know, you may not be able to find the right kind of employment. So people are thinking about that. What happens as we go into the future and, you know, there isn't work to do? And we're not there yet, but I think where we are now, that's really tough on our society. You know, we've got, I don't really want to use the phrase, you know, underclass, but we've got folks that forever, I mean, they don't have the skills, they don't have the education, and I mean, what's their, how are they able to contribute to society? And it's like some of those quotes. If you can't contribute to society, well, then you're just going to be discontent and things are going to go bad. So, ma'am.
Thank you. I'm a retired elementary school teacher, and I'm glad to hear you reference lifelong learning. My dilemma is that as a teacher, that was part of my mission, to create lifelong learners and make my students enjoy learning so that they would want to continue to learn. In our current education system, there is such an emphasis on testing and getting through the curriculum without taking the time to help the kids who are struggling. And frankly, that's one of the reasons I retired, when I was told that I had to move through the curriculum as it was printed and not take the time to help the kids who needed some more help. But how do we move into this economic situation that we're moving into without having a education system that creates lifelong learners? And as long as the test is supreme, we're going to create good test takers, but not lifelong learners. How do we get the powers that be to understand that and move in a different direction?
I mean, that's a great question. You're probably much more equipped to address that than I am. So think about this whole lifelong learning thing. Who takes advantage of lifelong learning in the country today? Pardon? Well, retired people, but who else? The educated people. The people that are already pretty well equipped. So the people that are really working the lifelong learning and, you know, staying out there on the edge of these new innovations are the ones that are already up several rungs on the ladder. So they're the ones that are already educated. They're the ones that wanted to learn and would do, you know, but for whatever reason, you know. So they're the ones that are taking advantage of it. And so what are you doing now? Now you're just creating a bigger gap from the ones at the top and the ones at the bottom. So I don't know how you fix it, but I know, you know, I'm on the faculty at the Army War College, so I guess I shouldn't say I'm not a professional educator, but I'm really not a professional, don't let that one get back either. I'm not a professional educator, but that's a real challenge. So what kind of education policy program do we need to have in place? How do we put that program in place? What kind of skills should we focus on? I mean, do we need to go to this apprenticeship model that Germany's using to great effect? Do we need to re-energize this VOTEC system that's not real popular? Is there some other way that we can think about it? And you know, there's a lot of discussion. You know, industry's really concerned about it because they're looking for who's our future workforce. So they don't necessarily want to have to do all the training on their dime, but they certainly recognize that we need skilled folks. I mean, you know, the military even thinks about that. You know, the military is concerned about, okay, what's our base of future recruits in terms of the skills that they have. So it's a huge challenge, and I don't know the answer. So maybe that'll show up in next, you know, one of the topics, education policy. So, yes, sir.
I guess this is more of a political science question, but you're talking about getting rid of cash. To a young person, how soon would you have to decide whether you want to run for political office if everything you ever bought was on some data system somewhere? Because, you know, you see all the research that goes on. Each party does a lot of research on your back, whatever you did in your whole life. Your entire life would be on a data system somewhere because everything you buy would be listed somewhere.
So you just don't release your returns, and then you're okay. No. That's... So, no, you're right. I don't know. It's like Facebook. You know, everybody's out there on Facebook, and sometimes we look at some of that and we say, oh, man, I wish you wouldn't have put that on Facebook. You know, I go on Facebook. The only reason I go, I have a Facebook account so I can figure out what my kids are doing. So I can go out there and check, you know, every once in a while they'll post a picture and, you know, so I can, oh, I didn't know you were up to that. But sometimes you'll go out there and say, man, I can't believe you put that out there on the public record. Really? You want to do that? So I don't know how that's going to play out in terms of, I guess the bottom line could be that, you know, we got a great country and we're going to have solid citizens that are, you know, we're going to have some solid citizens out there that we can look at their record through history and we can say, okay, maybe that person, you know, bought too many bags of M&Ms, but we'll let them go with that. And, you know, I don't know, that we're going to have some solid folks that we can get by with that. So I don't know, but it's an interesting thing to think about. Yes, sir.
One of my concerns about the Trans-Pacific trade idea was not so much economic as political. One of the proposals was that a corporation that lost money because of some national country's actions could sue that country for damages. And my concern is that the world may soon be ruled by multinational corporations, which will be much more powerful than any national government of most of the world.
No, and that's a fair concern and consideration. I know there's been a lot of discussion. You know, I have not taken the time to read the detailed laydown of the TPP negotiation. And so I know that was one of the concerns. And so, you know, and that's why I didn't have the quote, but I guess Stiglitz, when he talked about globalization, said we've really done a poor job of managing globalization. And so one of his big critiques is in terms of the power of transnational corporations. And so you're right. I mean, there's something that, in terms of the dispute settlement mechanisms that are built in there, and who really has the advantage. I mean, I forget the Disney movie. It was, the little robot I forget the name of the little robot, but it was all about his antagonist was the Big N, which was this huge global conglomerate that sort of controlled the world. But so there is, you know, some of that concern out there in terms, and that's this inequality type stuff, that the people at the top, the CEOs, when you think about pay scales and that kind of thing, you know, they used to, and I don't know the statistics, but, you know, the CEO of General Motors, you know, at one point in time, maybe he made, I don't know, 5, 6, maybe 10 times as much as a typical worker in General Motors. And now, you know, the multiple is 100 or more than that. And so you look at that kind of stuff, and that's why that's why we got to be concerned about what the eaches are in those kind of agreements. So it's a very good concern. Yes, sir.
All right, we have time for one more question.
Thank you for all the information today. My question is about the budget deficit that the United States government has, which is nearly $20 trillion, most of it financed by other countries, including China. With that, how much leverage do we have over China, and can we bully China now that we are indebted to them by a lot of money?
No, that's a great question. And so, you know, we've talked about the trade deficit. So there's the budget deficit that we're concerned about. And the budget deficit is going south. The numbers have been pretty good lately during the Great Recession. You know, we were up to about 4 or 5 years in a row. We had like a $1 trillion deficit. Then it dropped back very significantly. People were surprised how fast it went down. But the projections are that it's headed towards $1 trillion again and not the too distant future. So the annual deficit then builds into the debt, the gross debt. So the gross debt is up there around, I don't know what the number is, close to $20 trillion or about the size of our gross domestic product. China owns a portion of that. I mean, the actual foreign ownership of our debt has gone down in the last couple of years. Some of that is because of that quantitative easing stuff I showed you up there. So that is a concern, you know, that's part of this integrated economy. And so you have this, you know, I talked about this mutual assured production. Well, there's sort of this mutual assured financial integration as well. So the Chinese still own probably $2 trillion of U.S. debt. Now, probably it's close to about right around $1 trillion of U.S. Treasury debt, and then they've invested in some other securities as well. Japan right now is the biggest holder of U.S. debt. So the thought is the Chinese could threaten to dump their debt on the market and put us in a real problem. You know, there's the saying that goes, try to think if I get this right. If you owe the bank $1,000, you have a problem. If you owe the bank $1 million, the bank has a problem. So the bank needs to ensure that you're going to stay solvent. So, yeah, you're right. I mean, it's almost as too big to fail. So the Chinese have got this pile of money out there. If they start to unload it, the value of what they've got is going to collapse. So they've just shot themselves in the foot. If they start to unload it and it causes a ripple effect to the U.S. economy, the ability of the U.S. economy to buy $600 billion worth of Chinese goods is going to go down. The Chinese economy is going to suffer. So, and if the Chinese sell a bunch of U.S. debt, what are they going to buy instead? Are they going to buy the yen? You know, they don't get along too well with Japan. Are they going to buy the euro? Yeah, probably not so much. The euro is still on pretty shaky ground. So there's no real alternative. So the argument is that we're probably pretty safe, that it's not in their interest to do it, and we think we can make it work. Now, the other thing that's, you know, sort of a recent evidence of that relationship is, you know, their reserves have gone down by $1 trillion. $4 trillion to $3 trillion. $1 trillion is a lot of money. And so they put that back on the market. And our interest rates have gone up, but they've really only gone up because the Fed wants them to go up. That's the way we want to go. So it hasn't had that big of an impact. The global market has been able to absorb it. So I think that relationship is going to hold. But it is It is one that's certainly worth consideration, and I know the folks in the U.S. Treasury, you know, that's on their list to think about in terms of, you know, debt, who owns our debt, and what the nature of that relationship is. I think we're going to be okay, but it is something that's got to be, you know, sort of continually watched and considered. So thanks for the question.